Hi everyone. Hi. Welcome for tonight's visual culture lecture. We have the pleasure to have with us tonight Nina Power and Marvin Chetwynd. And the discussion following the presentation will be chaired by Michael Newman. So I will give a brief introduction to the series, and I will introduce Michael, and then Michael will introduce our guest. The visual culture lecture series is called Orientation, Locate and Reshape. During the last academic year, the series addressed the theme of global transformations and facilitated discussions between artists, historians, theorists, and cultural critics. This year, in order to better understand the context in which art is made and received, we plan to extend the debate from our cultural to and contextual awareness of global change through a focused engagement on cultural identities, considering themes such as national and cultural belonging, gender identities, and politics of technology. We aim to create a platform of knowledge exchange through the series of talks. And each event will host, as you can see, two guests and then a conversation chaired to debate the subjects. So I will introduce briefly Michael. Michael Newman has been professor of art writing at Goldsmiths since 2008. While simultaneously serving as a visiting tutor for Lesley University's MFA program and the tenured associate professor at the School of Fine Arts Institute of Chicago. He served as head of art history and theoretical studies at Slade School of Fine Art for 4 years, in 1994-1998. He has lectured for art programs at Central St. Martin's of Art and Design, UCL's Slade School of Fine Arts, the University of Warwick Art History Department, and Canterbury School of Architecture. Outside of art, he has worked as a course tutor for the University of Essex Philosophy Department, teaching the second and third year course Philosophy and Psychopathology on Freud and Lacan, and Art, Reason, and Modernity, Benjamin Adorno and Marcuse. I just want to make a short announcement that Michael will be talking for the finissage event at Raven Row on the 26th of March in the afternoon. And it will be for the finissage of the show called This Way Out of England, which was created by Anthony Hudek and Alex Sainsbury. It will be with a lecture performance organized by Gareth Bell-Jones, and Michael Newman will be in conversation with Sanja Perovic. So please welcome warmly Michael, who will introduce now Nina Power and Marvin Gaye Chetwynd.
Thanks, Anne. That's the longest introduction I've ever had as a chair. Very kind. I will be brief. The topic is how to interpret the contemporary. Do we still have a subconscious? So maybe we'll have answers to both of those by the end from Nina and Marvin. I'll introduce both now, and then they'll speak after that. And then we'll have 20 minutes or so discussion, and then open it to you. Nina Power received her PhD in philosophy from Middlesex University on the topic of humanism and anti-humanism in post-war French philosophy, and also has an MA and a BA in philosophy from Warwick. She's taught at Middlesex, Orpington College, London School of Communication, Morley College, and Roehampton University, where she is also currently a senior lecturer in philosophy. She's a fellow of the RSA and a member of the British Philosophical Association. She is co-editor of Alain Badiou's On Beckett with Cleaner Men and author of many articles on European philosophy, politics, culture, feminism, and also of the book, very well-known book, One Dimensional Woman, which came out in November 2009 with Zero Books. And she writes for magazines, newspapers, including The Wire, Strike, The Guardian, and Radical Philosophy. Marvin Gaye Chetwynd's practice combines performance, sculpture, painting, installation, and video, and is often collaborative, of course, as well. Her performances and videos harness elements of folk plays, street spectacles, literature, and multiple other genres. They generally involve troupes of performers, friends, and relatives of the artists, and feature handmade costumes and props. In 2012, she was nominated for the Turner Prize, and last year was in the Liverpool Biennale, working through workshops and live performances with 34 children and 44 teenagers from across Liverpool to make the film Dogs Eat My Bone, using the city as a backdrop. For over a decade, she has also worked on an extensive series of paintings, collectively titled Bat Opera. So I will now vacate the platform.
Right. Shall I? All right. Well, thank you for the invitation. Because I think probably I still feel like I'm at school or something, I approach these two questions about the subconscious and the contemporary as something like homework. So I thought that I would go first because it will be much more likely to be slightly drier than the second presentation. So I tried to answer these questions, maybe slightly naively. Do we still have a subconscious? How to interpret the contemporary? In the wake of, I guess, the political climate. So it might be a bit misery-inducing, I'm afraid. Okay, so I want to begin with the question of what we mean when we talk about the contemporary. Here we might just understand the contemporary or contemporaneity as another word for the now, or perhaps how things are at the moment slightly negatively understood. Or as an institutional term, as in, for example, the Gallery Nottingham Contemporary. We are, of course, never quite contemporaneous with ourselves or with each other, but the contemporary seems to be something we often attempt to summarize in a more or less totalizing way. We might talk about contemporary ideas or contemporary beliefs, or attempt to capture a particular mood of the period which we believe that we find ourselves in. As Peter Osborne puts it, as a historical concept, the contemporary involves a projection of unity onto the differential totality of the times of lives that are in principle or potentially present to each other in some way at some particular time, and in particular now, since it is the living present that provides the model of contemporaneity. The concept of the contemporary projects a single historical time of the present as a living present, a common, albeit internally disjunctive, historical time of human lives. The contemporary, in other words, Osborne says, is shorthand for the historical present. But I think one of the things we should bear in mind is, I suppose, this sense of disconnect or sort of time out of joint kind of feeling. That one can only have a sort of contemporary, one can have only been a contemporary of someone in the past. You don't speak of your fellow as contemporaries in the present if you're describing them very often. As Osborne continues, there is no actual shared subject position of or within our present from the standpoint of which its relational totality could be constructed as a whole, in however temporally fragmented or dispersed or incomplete a form. So I think we're stuck with this idea of the contemporary as a profound vagueness, and I think sometimes this comes across in when we're talking about contemporary art. What on earth is contemporary doing there? It's often sort of like this floating word. And I don't think it's necessarily a stand-in for the idea of being critical or anything else particularly. So we're kind of stuck with this word, not knowing who we are, either individually or collectively, but attempting anyway to try to describe the current state of things. And I think this, at least in the title, might be where the subconscious comes in or the unconscious comes in. So while debates continue to rage about whether we should be talking about the unconscious or the subconscious, and early Freud used both terms, I'm not so much interested in this question of definition as much as I am interested in attempting to locate where or if the unconscious resides in relation to this contemporary, which we can nevertheless not fully understand. Given this, the unconscious seems like maybe the best or perhaps only place to start, but with all of those provisos and caveats. Yet here dangers lie. If we try, for example, to analyse the supposed unconscious motivations of the contemporary, particularly with a view perhaps to understanding and thus preventing contemporary forms of fascism, particularly brought into view in the recent debates and now closure of the LD50 gallery in Hackney, which was protested against because they were holding fascist events, outright events there. So if we're trying to kind of understand what's happening, we run the real risk of understanding nothing. As Klaus Tavelite, whose 1977 Male Fantasies volumes brilliantly attempts to examine, where he's looking at kind of proto-Nazi Freikorps fantasies, as revealed in kind of various letters, imageries, and imagery and songs, particularly those fantasies concerning women. Tavelite highlights the danger of assuming that one is talking in the right way about the unconscious, right? And this is a quote from Tavelite. Whenever the word communism is mentioned in our sources, not as the collective organization of social production, but as a fear of being castrated by a sensuous woman armed with a penis, its usage is so overt and deliberate that, as far as I'm concerned, we really can't talk about an unconscious displacement or an unconscious fear. On the contrary, it strikes me that concealing the kinds of thoughts we've been discussing, the ones traditional psychoanalysis would call unconscious, is the last thing on earth these men would want to do. They're out to express them at all costs. The fear of castration is a consciously held fear, just as the equation of communism and rifle woman is consciously made. So it may well be that what we are looking for and looking at lies hidden, perhaps in plain sight, and that we perhaps should take people at their word. Tavelite again. Until now, it seems fascists themselves have been questioned too little about fascism, whereas those who claim to have seen through fascism but were unable to defeat it have been questioned too much. Drawing on Freud, he adds that Freud once commented that doctors have a tendency to dismiss patients' assertions as gross exaggerations. He went on to say, this is Freud, "In my opinion, the patients are once again nearer to a correct view than the doctors, for the patients have some glimmering notion of the truth, while the doctors are in danger of overlooking an essential point." Regrettably, Tavelite says, most theorists of fascism have acted towards fascists as those doctors did towards their patients. Nevertheless, taking into account Tavelite's kind of concern and worry about the unconscious, I think it is instructive to look back at sincere attempts to uncover the fascist unconscious. And I think nowhere is this more the case within with the authoritarian personality, the Studies in Prejudice series, that was the project of Adorno, Frankel Brunswick, and many others published in 1950. They described their research as guided by the following major hypothesis: that the political, economic, and social convictions of an individual often form a broad and coherent pattern, as if bound together by a mentality or spirit, and that this pattern is an expression of deep-lying trends in his personality. Their major concern then was with what they describe as the potentially fascistic individual, one whose structure is such as to render him particularly susceptible to anti-democratic propaganda. Crucially, they say potential, because they were not studying individuals who were avowedly fascistic, right? So not people who describe themselves explicitly in that way or who belong to fascist organizations. As they say, at the time when most of their data was collected, fascism had just been defeated in the war, so this is 1950, and they were not really expecting to find subjects who openly identified in that way. Yet they claim there was no difficulty in finding subjects whose outlook was such as to indicate that they would readily accept fascism if it should become a strong or respectable social movement, once again. So they use this idea of the F scale, the proto-fascism scale, whose variables were the following. I'm just going to list them because they're quite interesting. I think to maybe wonder about what we might use today if we were going to use similar variables, or whether this project is in a sense perhaps dated in particular ways. Okay, so nevertheless, they talked about conventionalism, which they described as adherence to middle class values, authoritarian submission, authoritarian aggression, the punishment of people who reject conventional values, what they call anti-interception, opposition to the subjective, the imaginative, the tender-minded, perhaps artists might say, superstition and stereotypy, so a belief in mystical individual fate and in rigid categories, an obsession with power and toughness, destructiveness and cynicism, including what they describe as vilification of the human, projectivity, the projection of unconscious emotional impulses, particularly the belief that the world is a dangerous place, and exaggerated concern with sexual goings-on, whatever these goings-on are. And we can see sort of aspects of Reich's project in that, an attempt to kind of describe in a kind of Freudian way what the unconscious drives might be behind fascist individuals. I think we might want to update some of these variables if we were going to do such a similar project. I would centre perhaps the extreme use of irony as opposed to conventionalism, and maybe mocking, and maybe a more anarchic model of punishment and power, particularly online. And I think, what about this question of the online then, if we're talking about the unconscious and the contemporary? I think although we live in an age wherein one can identify as many things on the basis of self-declaration, the limits to this operation become immediately apparent when attempted as a political tactic. And I think this is maybe one of the big divides between online life and real life, if we want to say that. One cannot identify out of being a refugee, for example, because there are so many people lining up to say, no, of course you cannot be British, even when, for example, you've been granted, though in ever fewer cases, asylum or citizenship. Huge blocks inhibit many from achieving the status of individual within particular geographies, with large groups characterised as both victim and threat, and sometimes both at once. As the recent calls for the use of dental x-rays to reveal the age of refugees coming to Britain, there are those deemed worth helping, and then there are the others. And one can be differentiated from the other on the basis of reductive biological facts, in inverted commas, though I want to note that the British Dental Association, not normally noted for their militancy, condemned this proposal by a Tory MP as unethical, as well as practically unworkable. So I think there are we have to acknowledge that there are identities within identities only for some, then. Online, an ever-expanding but unacknowledged Freudianism reigns. The id's primal instincts, in particular our aggression, are permitted free movement under the cloak of anonymity, or a relative kind of anonymity. Nice men become monstrous misogynists. Calm, friendly diplomats become relentless trolls. Gaiji's virtual ring, the ring that turns you invisible, makes assholes. Assholes? I spelt it in the American way. Assholes. Of everyone. Of us all. We are a long way... Why did I write that? We are a long way from the... from the cyber-utopianism of the 1990s. So I remember the tail end of this. A lot of it quite feminist thinking about what it might be to be online, and it would be kind of the exploration of multiple identities, pretending to be lots of different people, but it would be kind of nice and interesting. It wouldn't be what actually happened. So how best should we consider the time of the contemporary, or whatever word, this kind of incomplete, impossible contemporary, our current moment? We need a new way of thinking about the political transcendental conditions for the possibility of conceiving reality. So when Kant states that space and time are forms of sensible intuition, without which any experience would be inconceivable, so Kant says we can't think outside of space and time, we must, I think, subverting Kant, ask what are the conditions through which we must understand politics today and the horizon of possibility for political struggle. It makes sense, I think, to begin then with those people most dispossessed of space and time as such. And those who are forced to have the most extreme relation to space and time. This is the horizon of a contemporary politics where there is no horizon of possibility for a good life. where time is suspended in the form of indefinite detention in a refugee camp, where life is lived in limbo, where any possibility of an existence in the sense we might understand, the possibility to form social relations, to work, to travel, is radically curtailed or indeed halted altogether. In a related way, we can think about the state's weaponization of time, where bail and the wait for the asylum interview, the appeal process, the knock on the door, constitute an enforced, anxious and paranoiac relation to the clock and the calendar. To be invisible on your own terms, your IP address buried, your face covered with a balaclava, is one thing. To be anonymized as part of a mass or a mob, or treated as a lump of humanity held in limbo in camps, to be stateless, is another thing entirely. To choose not to be an individual or to operate under pseudonymity presupposes a flexibility that is not granted to those without multiple means of subversion. To be an individual, whether as a debtor, a worker, or a consumer, is to have, however negatively, a relation to the future. To be denied a relation to the future is to be also, though, a potential without limit. But I think at the moment, in place of a communist internationalism, we have the rise of new nationalisms that seek to foreclose on individuality and that seek to claim that there is some inherent tie between one's contingent identity as a being in a certain place in a certain time and the political geography that names you. It is a limited, fearful, and angry subject formation that denies both the possibility of individuality in the other, but also denies the necessity of group solidarity and action. And I think there's a strong sense in which all of these kind of authoritarian nationalists have no problem having this kind of internationalism amongst themselves. But this is obviously the very opposite of a communist image of internationalism. So just to go back to the point about fascism and what might be a better, I don't know, a more useful approach in the contemporary moment. So whilst just 0.18% of the total population of the UK at the moment are refugees, newspapers and the government are nevertheless, of course, relentlessly pursuing the language of spatial squeeze, of Britain as a country that is quote-unquote full up. We can think of the language of the contemporary moment as a form of the architecture of fear. And I suppose I want to pose as a question whether a close analysis of language and the language of the contemporary escapes the problems raised by Taverlight in terms of trying to unpick or discover an unconscious beneath the language. And in this sense, I want to just finish by looking briefly at Victor Klemperer's work, who wrote this amazing book based on his diaries called The Language of the Third Reich. You know, as a Jewish man in Nazi Germany, as a philologist and a scholar, looking at the language everywhere around him. So when Klemperer describes the language of the Third Reich, he points out the quote, "The most powerful influence was exerted neither by individual speeches nor by articles or flyers, posters or flags. It was not achieved by things which one had to absorb by conscious thought or conscious emotions. Instead, Nazism permeated the flesh and blood of the people through single words, idioms, and sentence structures which were imposed on them in a million repetitions and taken on board mechanically and unconsciously." So in a sense, there's another way of perhaps positioning the unconscious there through this kind of imposed repetition. "We only have to think of the use of certain words in relation to the construction of a fear of the refugee and the asylum seeker and the migrant, flood, crowding, the use of large anonymizing numbers, millions, thousands, and of course the endless blurring of the categories with each other and also with words like terrorist." So finishing by returning to Klemperer's analysis of the language of the Third Reich, we can ask the following questions, I think. How are things said? What concepts are forbidden? How has emotive content become attached to particular terms in the contemporary period? Is the use-mention distinction, whereby using a word and mentioning it are understood to be different things, which is a famous problem online, whereby if you mention something, it's often perceived as if you are directly saying it or making this claim. You know, the use-mention distinction, which is central to the contextualizing of claims and rational argumentation, has this been dissolved in the partisan attempt to draw up linguistic battle lines? When Klemperer describes the language of the Third Reich as no longer drawing a distinction between spoken and written languages, language, and this is one of his key claims, that everything reads as if it's a speech, so including written language, so there's no differentiation. I think this is one of the major key points he makes. It's very interesting. Can we today talk about the blurring of the distinction perhaps between the written language and the image in perhaps the online prevalence of the meme? And I'm just going, I'll leave it there. Okay.
So I've got lots of friends and family in the audience, which is good. I was going to say that I worked out during Nina's presentation that I'm really bursting for the loo. And I just thought, oh, yeah, what am I going to do? This is so annoying. But I've had a brainwave. I'm going to put on the clip that I want to show. And I'm going to go to the loo and then I'm going to come back. So one of the clips is, I took the title seriously too.
I just meant
that innocently. Like, I really did take it. I took it like it's weirdly. I took it seriously. Oh, has anyone seen Pervert's Guide to Cinema? The Zizek? But I think it's by Sophie Fiennes. And it's made in 2006. So in that amazing documentary film, there's a really great bit where he talks about the Marx brothers and Harpo Marx, where he's chasing women around a ship as being pure id. So I thought this was in reference to Harpo. So that's good. And then the next thing I took seriously was I started thinking about my relationship with the subconscious. And I have a very friendly relationship. And I don't think of it as a place where someone can pop into it and manipulate me. I think of it as a place that's like an incredible arena where I can be very creative and free. So that was something I worked out. And then I also thought about the documentary series by Adam Curtis called The Century of the Self. I'm guessing lots of people have seen. I think it's 2002. And that maps like the creation of PR and marketing. And it looks at the direct contact with Sigmund Freud's work to his nephew, I think it is, called Bernays, and how he starts actually just this massive chain of events that ends up being sort of market research. And then there are many series, but it ends up upsettingly with our sort of recent politicians and this kind of like how spin doctoring and sort of repulsive that whole thing is. So that's a really another series that I thought about. Mm-hmm. And then I thought, do you know what? I'm going to talk about my favorite models of like people at the moment, for sure. I'm sad they're not women, I'm afraid. It's Harold Pinter, and the other one's Frank Zappa. So I was going to say that what I like about them is that they're like conscious, rational civilians, as it were, like citizens, who scrutinize the government and criticize and speak out and are incredibly aware and clever when it comes to analyzing current affairs in their lifetime. But then they also had a really amazing relationship with allowing themselves to be like sort of blind, visionary, creative types. So they allowed a very strange, almost, I was going to say, like a zone to happen, to open up for them, where they didn't bring their conscious civilian personality into it. And they made sure that they didn't make work that was preaching or like a sermonizing. They allowed themselves to be within this kind of swamp or mulching area where ideas came to them in a kind of abstract way. Are you following what I'm talking about? Okay, because I care. So there's a level where I was interested in Harold Pinter's speech for the Nobel Prize that he won. And he's kind of, I don't know, looking a bit frail on the way out. And I thought it was amazing because I watched it and it's 2005, so I was really impressed by it. I tried to talk about it to someone recently, and annoyingly, all they said was that they couldn't get past the fact that you could hear him going, which really annoyed me, actually. I was really annoyed by that. I just thought, my God, I mean, like, whoa. But anyway, I'm going to show a clip of that, I might go to the loo during that, because that might be a long one. Then the other clip I was going to show was about the recent film, which is Frank Zappa's Eat That Question. Has anyone seen that? Yeah? Yeah. Because it's amazing. So I'm going to show the trailer to that as well. My 20 minutes is probably up already. But all I wanted, the point I wanted to ram home is that I think it's incredible when a person can be incredibly rational and conscious and critical of their current situation and environment and contribute to it, but then can also maintain a field where they are opened up to what I would say subconscious and a form of intuitive and instinctive creativity. It's clear, isn't it? It's pretty damn clear. Okay, that's it. That's my point. So I'm going to show you the clips, and I can also show some of my own stuff. I don't mind doing that. And then something else as well, niggling at me. I'd be happy to talk about current projects and to explain like where I'd get an idea from. And it would be, for example, I just need a sip of water. You know, like, how do I say it? Quite a conventional idea of research where you actually go to a library and you look at books and other research forms like talking to people and this kind of thing, in conversation, watching documentaries. So I do a lot of that. I'd say I call it sort of gleaning. And then I will allow a kind of letting go to happen. And then I get an overwhelming rush of ideas that comes through. And that rush of ideas I will then take to a group of people who are around me, whether it's people at a bus stop or my friends or whoever's around me. And I'll suggest doing something live with those ideas. And I can give you some examples, so it's not just talking abstractly. At the moment, I'm really interested in researching Abbé Pierre, who founded and set up Emmaüs. I'm really interested in researching his life. I like the way he walked through life. It's interesting to me. And also, I'm super interested in researching Chernobyl and the sarcophagus and the sort of international engineering that's managed to rebuild and keep safe Chernobyl zone. And then also there's more there as well, which is recently I saw a film called The Babushkas of Chernobyl, which is super interesting too. So I can talk a little bit more about that. But that's it. So at the moment I'm going to set these clips going, hopefully. Thanks. So it's the internet. I'm going to put him on. Okay. Where's the beginning? Okay, I'm going to go to the loo. Is that all right? I'll be quick. Can I just check it's all right before I go? Is everything working? And the volume and everything? I don't need to worry about it, do I?
I'm very sorry, but I can't be in Stockholm.
Is it too loud?
In 1958, I wrote the following. There are no hard distinctions between what is real and what is unreal, nor between what is true and what is false. A thing is not necessarily either true or false. It can be both true and false. I believe that these assertions still make sense and do still apply to the exploration of reality through art. So, as a writer, I stand by them. But as a citizen, I cannot. As a citizen, I must ask, what is true? What is false? Truth in drama is forever elusive. You never quite find it, but the search for it is compulsive. The search is clearly what drives the endeavor. The search is your task. More often than not, you stumble upon the truth in the dark, colliding with it, or just glimpsing an image or a shape which seems to correspond to the truth, often without realizing that you've done so. But the real truth is that there never is any such thing as one truth to be found in dramatic art. There are many. These truths challenge each other, recoil from each other, reflect each other, ignore each other, tease each other, are blind to each other. Sometimes you feel you have the truth of a moment in your hand, then it slips through your fingers and is lost. I've often been asked how my plays come about. I cannot say. Nor can I ever sum up my plays, except to say that this is what happened. That is what they said. That is what they did. Most of the plays are engendered by a line, a word, or an image. The given word is often shortly followed by the image. I shall give two examples of two lines which came right out of the blue into my head, followed by an image, followed by me. The plays are The Homecoming and Old Times. The first line of The Homecoming is, "What have you done with the scissors?" The first line of Old Times is, "Dark." In each case, I had no further information. In the first case, someone was obviously looking for a pair of scissors and was demanding their whereabouts of someone else he suspected had probably stolen them. But I somehow knew that the person addressed didn't give a damn about the scissors or about the question either, for that matter. Dark, I took to be a description of someone's hair, the hair of a woman, and was the answer to a question. In each case, I found myself compelled to pursue the matter. This happened visually, a very slow fade through shadow into light.
Are you enjoying it? Do you want me to keep going with it?
I would start a play by calling the characters A, B, and C. In the play that became The Homecoming, I saw a man enter a stark room and ask his question of a younger man sitting on an ugly sofa reading a racing paper. I somehow suspected that A was a father and that B was his son, but I had no proof. This was, however, confirmed a short time later when B, later to become Lenny, says to A, later to become Max, "Dad, do you mind if I change the subject? I want to ask you something. The dinner we had before, what was the name of it? What do you call it? Why don't you buy a dog? You're a dog cook, honest."
Okay, maybe all I was going to say was he's brilliant, but I think it got to the point where he talks quite like abstractly about how he works. Is that right? A, B, C, D. Had I got to the right place? Brilliant. Okay, that's great. And then this is the fun one as well.
I don't think that anybody has ever seen the real Frank Zappa, because being interviewed is one of the most abnormal things that you can do to somebody else. It's the two steps removed from the Inquisition.
Zappa has often seemed to be a force of cultural darkness, bearded and gross and filthy, a lone, brutal reminder of music's potential for invoking chaos and destruction.
I'm famous, but most people don't even know what I do.
Always a freak, but never a hippie. Frank Zappa on Frank Zappa.
You're very packaging oriented, aren't you?
You've got kids.
Yeah, I have a wife, four kids, mortgage, the works. I've never taken any acid. I've smoked about 10 joints over a period of 9 years.
Isn't it strange, the fantasies that people have?
I hate to see anybody with a closed mind on any topic. And then people started telling me that my melodies were ugly. Dirty words don't exist. This is a fantasy. fantasy that is manufactured by religious fanatics and government organizations to keep people stupid.
God, I am the American dream, with a spindle up my butt till it makes me scream.
Society decides for itself what will be sinful.
So little chance of escaping that cycle.
We're not concerned enough about the quality of our lives.
Aesthetic enrichment, this is not a major consideration in the United States.
There is a deep, permanent, irreversible cynicism in you.
And I wish that I could have other people catch some of it.
Okay, so that's good fun, isn't it? So am I up with my 20 minutes? Who's in charge? Anne? Five minutes of my own stuff. Okay, here we go. Right, so hard an act to follow. Nina Power and Frank Zappa and Harold Pinter. So let's have a go. I was going to show some of this one, which I have to go like that, don't I?
Au centre CNES de Toulouse l'été dernier, la conférence sur la vision verticale.
Oui, c'est exact. Nous travaillons avec vous à présent.
Oui, c'est exact. Nous travaillons avec vous à présent.
Nous étions dans les sports extrêmes, le plongeon de haut vol, et nous gérons une entreprise de vêtements de sport.
Faites-vous autre chose ?
C'est mon travail régulier. C'est ce que je fais pour gagner de l'argent. Mais ma principale raison de vivre, c'est la poésie. Nous adorons ce boulot, c'est du sérieux. C'est génial que l'Europe ait le CNES.
Oui, j'adore ce boulot. Je crois en l'avenir de l'Europe, dans l'espace, et je crois au CNES.
Mais c'est vrai, ma passion, ce sont les marionnettes. J'ai un théâtre de marionnettes, et il est collectionneur.
Oui, je suis collectionneur. Parfois, certains objets éveillent mon intérêt, et je me mets simplement à les collectionner. Puis quelque chose se passe dans ma tête, et généralement, un thème en ressort. Un lien censé se tisse entre mon esprit et les choses que je collectionne. Un lien basé sur des dialogues, pas sur la consommation.
Son instinct de collectionneur évolue dans le cadre de certains paramètres rigoureux, mais au sein de ceux-ci, il donne l'impression que ses instincts sont totalement libres, qu'il aura des pierres de toutes sortes, des objets en tout genre, appartenant au même registre, et qu'une partie de son rôle de collectionneur est d'essayer différentes manières d'exprimer...
Oh, did Anne enjoy that? Should I stop? Finished? One more minute? Half? Overtime? Okay, stop then. Okay. I stop. What do we do? Go and sit down. Yes? Yep. Thanks.
That was a fascinating and brilliant combination, which poses a dilemma, which I think is very much the dilemma of this moment. I thought, you know, Nina was fantastic in the way that she presented the political situation in relation to temporality, the authoritarian personality, and aspects of subjectivity, you know, angry subjectivity and so on. I think, you know, in a way we're faced with a odd temporality, which perhaps one could understand as some kind of fascist temporality. Perhaps fascism has a lot to do with temporality. On the one hand, a stasis, people deprived of a future, people without a future. And on the other hand, a kind of acceleration towards catastrophe or apocalypse, which some would want to bring on, you know, the sort of outright Steve Bannon idea of, you know, bring it on, let's destroy liberalism, let's destroy the current order, in the name of the angry. In addition to that, I think that something that's becoming increasingly important is political affect and the politics of affect. Affects which take on a political role. I was here a little while ago talking about shame and shamelessness. One could also talk about anger, as Nina did. Affects which take on a political role, but also the way that affects take on a sort of political momentum through technology, through being harvested, through big data, through targeting, you know, so that, you know, affects are being manipulated really in a new way, I think, because of technology. Affects have always been a part of politics. I mean, rhetoric was the old technology to deal with affects. But now, you know, we have new technologies to exploit and target in a way that has never been done before. So I think when we think about the unconscious now, or the subconscious, you know, we really need perhaps also to think in those terms. And I think Nina was right in terms of the Freikorps that Tavelight talks about in a fascinating way. And I'm kind of intrigued by, could one compare the Freikorps in some way as this threatened armored masculinity, you know, to, you know, sort of the outright on their computers, you know, the whole sort of Gamergate masculine culture that is through 4chan and memes generating a certain somewhat poisonous discourse at the moment. It's not unconnected with the LD50 episode. Altogether, that seems like a very bleak picture. That raises the question of, you know, how do we comport ourselves as citizens individually, but more importantly, perhaps collectively, and how to maintain the possibility for some sort of affirmative, generative, even joyful creation in those kinds of circumstances, and what is the relation between that and, you know, and how we deal with our political circumstances, which I think is something that came out from Marvin's presentation and from the Frank Zappa and the two videos that she showed. The Harold Pinter, of course, as well. As I emailed to her, you know, he's so menacing, even in his blanket, he's managing to be sort of menacing. It's, you know, it's still the London of the craze and, you know, the sort of menacing silence. That was an extraordinary speech, and I recommend you listen to the whole thing. So that would be really the question that I would pose. You know, what is the relation between these two sides? You know, how we live some kind of generative, affirmative life in the context of the darkening times that are upon us. Would one of you like to take that up, perhaps?
I can imagine Nina might. I can imagine.
Maybe. Yeah, I mean, I suppose on the Freikorps point of view, I mean, I didn't really describe the Taverlite book very well, but it's a fantastic book. He kind of takes up, in a way that very few people do, the kind of methodology and challenge presented by Deleuze and Guattari, in a way, like what it might mean to actually analyse something in a D&G type way. And the way he composes the book is as a kind of montage, so that there are many kind of images and photographs, but they're not sort of strictly illustrative in the sense of being secondary to the text. They are also kind of arguments. And I suppose I tried to say at the end that I'm very interested in this, I guess, trying to keep apart words and images in a way, and I don't know whether that's in itself a kind of dangerous impulse on my part, but I think I'm worried about various new forms of fusion, these things, in the same way that Klemperer is worried about this fusion of speech and written language. I suppose in the Freikorps example, so Taverlite looks at these kind of imagery of these bodies, the hard bodies of the Freikorps, and this kind of hyper-masculinity, which is not incompatible with a certain kind of homosociality and indeed homosexuality, but it's all about the kind of exclusion of the red woman, who is the communist, who is the bleeding sexual woman, if you like. So the only women permitted in these fantasies are the white women, who are the sisters and mothers of the other of people in the Freikorps. And you try to suggest that maybe it's a kind of link with, let's say, another self-declared army, the online army of men. And I mean, one of the major differences would probably be, I suppose, the hard body becomes a soft body if it just involves sitting behind a computer screen, but perhaps a kind of hard mind. And I suppose I'm trying to talk about what it might mean to have this kind of relative anonymity as a kind of cover story for then being able to say and think whatever you feel like, and whether this is psychoanalytically amenable, in the sense, are we talking about the id, or, you know, what are these kind of desires that are coming out? I mean, in terms of the kind of affirmative, generative, joyful creativity thing, I mean, I think those things will always exist. I think obviously we have to protect them. At the same time, I think we also have to be kind of careful and nuanced in our understanding of what's happening. I mean, it's very clear that there's a kind of authoritarianism that's possible. You know, I mean, it's not like humour in and of itself is a defence mechanism against fascism. It's completely compatible with it, you know, as is irony, as is creativity, as is, you know, do you see what I mean? Like, I don't think we can straightforwardly oppose these things. I mean, Marcuse, you know, a long time ago, talks about repressive desublimation, in the sense that, you know, there's always a kind of recuperation of creativity. You know, it's not straightforward that, you know, this will be opposed. You know, I mean, you know, capitalists have a lot of fun. I mean, they can spend all their money on, like, you know, sex and drugs and stuff. It's not like they're sitting, austerely, sort of. Do you know what I mean? So I don't know. I mean, maybe I'm kind of so unfun. I'm so against fun that I don't know.
I'm not sure that I was thinking so much about fun, but maybe putting the question another way. I think there's a connection between these questions around the body and the political body and notions of sovereignty. And, you know, that's the connection with the idea of the nation and defending the nation and excluding immigrants, excluding others from the nation. So there's a certain conception of the body linked to the certain conception of the political body. I mean, there's a gendered notion of the body, masculine, with a political body, with ideas of sovereignty. And there may be forms of performance even, perhaps Marvin, that throw that notion of exclusive sovereignty into question. Would that resonate at all with your?
I don't know. I'll be honest with you that I feel like if you're really talking about how we're really going to behave now, I can be honest and confess something that maybe offers something more. I don't know, in a more like reality level, so we can talk about something that really happened. That I was given an invitation through an email to join a show that was quite obviously meant to be countering the wave of right-wing politics that seems to be coming across Europe and across the world. And it was a kind of radical call, like, to join the this group show. So you added your name to the list to show your solidarity. Mm-hmm. But interestingly, I totally hesitated. And I thought, oh my God, it's just a could be just a blacklist. Like, it just could be by adding your name to this interestingly obviously proactive group that anyone else looking at the list could be seeing who are the artists to somehow marginalize or something like this. So I would say whenever I've been tested by any kind of form of fascism in a kind of straightforward in my contact within my decision making, I have not been outspoken and razzy and loud. Actually, I've ducked and I've mm-hmm. wanted more time to contemplate and to make my decision in how to behave. And a similar situation in a very strict job I once had, where the man in charge of us was basically quite sick, possibly. He was very strict with everyone. There was no laughing and no joking mm-hmm. on the work team. And I remember he sort of tested me once by taking me away from everyone to ask me something very strange in a corner where no one could hear. And again, I just managed to have an internal voice that processed, but externally I said something polite and got away as quickly as I could. And I was working in a way that enabled me to make small changes and be positive how I could, but to keep my head down. And if I'm being honest with you about how to behave, I don't necessarily feel like singing and dancing or making some sort of protest through play as the Cobra movement maybe would have. I actually feel more cautious and to speak with people who really know what's going on. But I just thought to enter, it seems like you're wanting to talk very seriously about current effect, how we are now. Mm-hmm. So that's my response at the moment. I hope it's helpful. Like I'm being honest and serious.
Well, maybe to take the discussion in the direction of the contemporary, you know, as part of the agenda. You know, a lot of people, I think, now are trying to think, well, what times in the past does this time connect up with? Mm. And they would maybe jump to the 1930s, particularly.
Or
the Guardian just did a couple
World
of
War
supplements.
Two, I think before the Second World War and after.
So I was going to ask you about that sort of use of historical
encouragement,
layering in a sense, or material in your work, or a kind of reactivation. You talked about the Abbé Pierre, for example.
Yeah,
how that functions in relation to the contemporary for you.
I don't know, I'm jumping around a bit, but I know, I agree. One of them would be that I listened to a speech on the radio, an interview with Tony Benn. And he was talking about his wartime experience of coming out of a bunker and, you know, mm-hmm. everything being destroyed and his best friend being dead and making such a massive impact on his life. And that he talked a lot about how demoralized and demoralizing capitalism is and the way that we live and so many motors and mechanisms to keep us in check and keep us demoralized. And I do realize that a lot of my work is to do with morale and to make people feel, you sort of feel encouraged to question and to be human. So I would say that, but then I will also cite people that I find in, I don't know whether it's the history of art or history in general, who I feel very encouraged by. So Abbé Pierre, certainly I'm really interested in his career, it's extraordinary. He went on, at one point when his charity didn't have any money, he went on the equivalent of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, it's called Double or Quit, and he won all the way to the top. And he just took the money and went back to doing what he was doing. I mean, he's definitely independent. And he criticized Mother Teresa, this is my favorite bit, because she wasn't critical enough of the church. So he's definitely walked his own walk and is enjoyably an individual. And he was obviously also very famous for the French, he was in the French resistance during the war. But I would say that it's relevant as well maybe to talk about, possibly, that I've been invited to work with this alternative biennial in Hungary called the Off Biennial. And that's really interesting, where the conservative government, and apparently in 2015, sort of ousted a lot of cultural figures and put very right-wing figures in their places. And then as an alternative sort of option, this Off Biennial has grown up. And they've come to me asking me to make work because they seem really desperate for someone who could address serious issues, but with joy and a certain amount of, I don't know how to put it, like lust for life is a good word, yeah. So I would definitely look to historical figures. The Hungarian one, they have one as well. It's a Lutheran priest this time. But I would definitely, I mean, it's just a yes. I would look to them for, I think for model, for alternative models, like how do you, templates or?
Models for how to live now.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And Nina, you were talking about time out of joint, and you know, in relation to this notion of a blocked future, I was wondering whether, you know, something like anachronism might be a resource, a sort of non-contemporaneity in the contemporary. I mean, maybe a similar question to the question I asked Marvin. And what would be the other relationship to time that would sort of blow open, if you like, that seeming closure?
I think I'm really worried about people who don't think about their own deaths ever, and I think there are loads of them now. I kind of constantly wonder whether Trump ever imagines that he's going to die, and the jury's out on this. I've discussed it with a lot of people, but I think, I mean, in all seriousness, I mean, it goes along with some of the kind of more extreme projects of Silicon Valley regarding immortality, and I have a student who's working on these people like Peter Thiel who are, you know, kind of obsessed with finding this cure for, I mean, cure for existence, cure for finitude. And I suppose I'm quite interested in a practical sense about what it means to think from that standpoint and think about what it is you actually have. I mean, of course, you don't know when you're going to die, but necessarily. But, you know, what it is you actually have in the present, you know, what it is you can actually do, practically speaking, you know, the Spinoza's question, you know, what can a body do? And I suppose, yeah, I think there are really difficult questions about these kind of deep emotions around anger and envy. And I think kind of, you know, we have to understand on some level that these are, you know, that these emotions are real, right? So when people feel genuinely aggrieved, that something is being taken from them. You know, this is a libidinal question, right? This is a question of the unconscious. And we have to understand, I think, kind of contemporary forms of fascist self-victimization, right? I think the fascist is the one who always feels that he or she has had something taken from them. And I think we have to understand that kind of psychoanalytically, and it's not the same as understanding one's own finitude, but it's a way of turning one's own lack into a weapon. Something like this. So I'm very kind of concerned to understand that. And I think this is this kind of political question of time. And I think for me, it's how do we start from the position of people whose relation to time is externally curtailed, right? Is externally blocked, who are basically being given no time and no space to do anything, to have any connections, to make any kind of, yeah, relation to the world.
I think this is the time where we should open this up, perhaps to comments and questions. Are there microphones going around? Yeah, there are microphones going around, so please wave your arms wildly in the air if you'd like to have one. Is there somebody who would like to make an intervention? Here, Claire.
Hi. I'd like to pick up on something that Nina was talking about memes, and about, if you like, the monetization of outrage, and how if something's dreadful enough, we'll all share it, and someone will make money off that. And I wondered if there was something about the Marvin's work which is really, this is what we should be doing, this is uplifting, rather than this kind of, oh my God, look how horrible it is, share it around, create traffic to their website, bring funding to their advertising revenue and all this kind of stuff. I wondered if there was a tactic that actually, even in bringing up, you know, talking about words and even the words themselves, if they're the wrong word, like the flood of refugees, even if you're putting that in quotation marks, you're still reinforcing the image. So I wondered if there was a kind of what the way around that is, and if it is literally just being like, no, I don't want to talk to you, don't want to talk about it, we're doing our own thing, you know.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of things I could say. I mean, I'm sort of very in general worried about the kind of violence of the image in general. I'm like very sort of worried and suspicious of images, and almost in that sort of quasi-religious sense, which maybe is a bit weird in an art context. But I think, you know, there are ways in which, you know, repetition of violent images or decontextualized images actually is very damaging, sort of morally and politically. I realise I did kind of imply at the end that memes or the fusion of word and image is sort of proto-fascist. But actually, I think emojis are worse than memes. But they're really fascist.
Painting's worse.
What?
Painting's worse.
Painting's worse. Okay, I didn't say that. He said that. Okay, so the monetization of outrage. Yeah, I mean, I think there is this kind of question. So like the circulation of images, like, so for example, the image of Alan Kurdi, the young boy who washed up on the beach, I mean, created a very massive, spontaneous, sentimental reaction. But this didn't translate into a kind of practical politics, right? Let's say people opening their doors to refugees. You know, it didn't have that kind of proximate political motivation. And I'm kind of interested in this relationship between proximity and sentimentality and empathy, or what it might mean to actually be moved enough by an image or images such that one would, you know, genuinely change one's behavior or offer something, as opposed to this vicarious or at one remove type. Kitch. Well, yeah, kitsch. And yeah, I mean, even aside from the monetization question, I suppose it's, yeah, the question of what these images are doing, I don't know. And I mean, I think, you know, just to finish, I mean, I'm very, very worried about, I suppose, the blurring of the boundary between kind of fictionalized images of violence and real images of violence. And if we cannot tell the difference between the two, then our politics are kind of blunted or stunted, right? But but this veers into kind of questions of, like, you know, moral philosophy and imagery. But yeah, I think the question makes a lot of sense.
I think what you said in your talk in relation to Klemperer on the kind of collapse of writing into speech,
yeah,
and the link of that with memes is very interesting, because I think the very notion of the image has shifted with memes and with other forms of technology, from being a representation to being something that circulates.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we get this in Hito Steil's idea of the poor image, the image that easily circulates. And I think people who use memes are using images as a form of speech, effectively. Their communication, regardless of what they represent. And even now, you know, there are more and more kinds of software where the image disappears, just as speech sort of disappears. It's fulfilled its function in being exchanged in some way, in forming some kind of group or rapport. So I wonder how that affects the situation, you know, the relation to the unconscious, to what you're talking about as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think in Hito's essay that it's kind of a defense of the poor image, ultimately, and, you know, in a complicated way, and, you know, because it's the process of reproduction, yeah, that is kind of being highlighted, and, you know, the fact that there is perhaps a hierarchy of images. Mm. And I suppose in the, you know, the meme idea, it's in a way the kind of crapper they are, the better they are. I mean, there's a kind of reversal of mm-hmm. of the, I don't know, mm-hmm. beauty and structure in a way. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, of course there are left-wing memes. You know, it's not that all memes are inherently right-wing. But I suppose I'm wondering about the impetus or the humour behind them. You know, whether that humour is what it means, I suppose, given that it seems to have exploded in a certain way, you know, that the humour that is a kind of damaging humour, perhaps.
Ooh. Marvin, what do you think about humour? I think Claire's question was directed towards you as well.
I like the question. The question was good. I was going to say, I've read, I don't know how to pronounce her name, it's a Hitosterial, but I'm just reading it how it says, but you might pronounce her name differently. That I've read the essay that you talked about, and I really loved it, in defence of the poor image, isn't it? It's fantastic. I really enjoyed the reference within it to the Cuban filmmakers from the 60s who also always wanted to work with a poor aesthetic, because they felt that any kind of slickness or making of work that's of a professionalized level is actually just aping and looking to the corrupt, horrible powers of Hollywood or wherever they were criticizing. And I found it very clear and mm-hmm. excitingly empowering reading her essay, so I really loved it. But when it comes to humor, obviously it's crucial, and I definitely do think that I have complete faith in humans, it seems, that I feel that however suppressive and whatever horrors come, it seems as if people just have some ability in contributing to that, and it's never just an oppressor, it always seems to be a combination of the oppressed contributing to. And I would answer the question happily that you put, that seemed to really connect us. That was great. I would say there is something in the way I work, which is to do a DIY, do it yourself, kind of, that does seem to offer autonomy in a time when everything does seem to be mm-hmm. taken away from you and the options are closing down. So I'm not saying in some radical, nightmarish way, come on, everybody, kind of, do it yourself. But it is obviously those options exist, and I guess you can quite easily forget that. But I don't seem to be able to forget it.
Well, humour, I guess, can be a community forming, and it can also be aggressive towards the other, and it's not always easy to distinguish mm-hmm. the two. I mean, sometimes it can form a community through aggression towards the other, or sometimes mm-hmm. it can form a community in a sort of affirmative carnivalesque way, mm-hmm. which seems to be more the direction the humour in your practice takes, as opposed to the humour of the...
I'm used to endlessly citing Mikhail Bakhtin's book, Rabelais and His World, because I'm really aware that carnival ultimately reinforces the power, because you're given a period of time to have fun and then you go back to work afterwards with a kind of compliant, happy soul. So I'm aware of all of those patterns and everything. And sometimes I give lectures by rolling around on the floor and then asking if people want me to go back to the lectern, because then that reinforces the fact that you're actually annoyed by the carnival side and you actually want to go back to the normality and the state that is helpful and I don't know what you call it, structured. I don't know, I'm not sure I'm wanting to speak about my use of humour so much. I'm interested in the slightly different languages that we speak and trying to connect. I'm trying to connect. I'm aware that I'm not as immersed in current affairs as Nina is, and I'd say that's something maybe that I can understand and relate to with my relationship to being instinctive and intuitive, because I do spend time not being connected to current affairs intentionally. So that seems to be something that's...
I do try to go to sleep occasionally, and that's not very well, but...
Yeah. The trouble is when I go to sleep and I wake up, I reach for the iPad. Go on to the newspapers, it's terrible.
Okay, see, I don't do that.
Like more and more, you know, there's something about the time, you know, you just want to see what, you know, is there going to be something happening that's going to improve things rather than make them worse and worse and worse. So I very much appreciate what you're saying about the need to kind of break away from that.
Well, actually, and it's your question that made it apparent in a weird way. But yes, yes.
And that maybe is also another dimension of the contemporary, of you know, not the, the sort of the oppressiveness of the contemporary, you know, to
open up
another
desperate
time within it somehow.
I'd say at the moment everyone's pretty desperate to gain some sort of control, or how would you say, like some sort of perspective. I would say everyone's. That's why everyone's scratching around and like wanting, like why you're reaching for the iPad.
Hello. Yeah. Thank you. I just wanted to go like a quick step back to Rita Steyer and her essay that I think that is really amazing, as well. but there are like quite different ways to understand it. As you put it. If we just look at it as like poor images, like I don't like to hear like again and again about like some pessimistic view on like memes and degraded images, and I don't like to hear over and over again about like some pessimistic view on degraded images and what they actually are able to destroy.
Why is it pessimistic?
No. Sorry. Well, then like. How do I put like
a different function that they
of course, of course. Like,
represent.
But what I'm asking, because we're talking about the contemporary moment right now, and what are the possibilities to use these kind of structures of communication, and I think that what Steyer actually points out is exactly this potential, not that they are degraded images or like that they are like. Just a mere, I don't know, small glimpse of what has been, but that it's the time now to look at these forms of communication differently, mm-hmm. and that the potential of it lies not what they are and how they've been used, maybe like after the World War, but how they are used now. Mm-hmm. And I think that there are many examples of millions of people out there. How they're used and not what they show. Like, mm-hmm. I think the idea of the meme, for instance, is not that they depict something or that they, mm-hmm. I don't know, judge something. It is that they're shown around and passed on. And I think it's just the time to realize that this is what we should look at and that this is like the contemporary moment mm-hmm. of looking at communication. So.
Do you want to come back on that?
I think he was just telling us, wasn't he?
Yeah.
I think it's all right. Don't you think? I think that was he was clearing up a point that he felt annoyed by.
But I think it's an important point to make. You know, the shift in the use of images. Yeah.
Sorry, made a note. How would you respond to LD50 gallery way of speculating on the notion of democracy, where they were calling out all the pro-immigration and left-wing people as not democratic because they don't give a platform for, I don't know, KKK's representative to speak out loud? How would you respond to that? Because obviously it's quite speculative on the notion of democracy, I think. They were trying to fight for equal rights.
Okay, so that's an important question.
Yeah, I mean, I guess a quick answer. I mean, you know, free speech doesn't float in some kind of abstract neutral space. You know, free speech is always tied to questions of the freedom of association and spatial questions, right? So the fact that this gallery is in Hackney, you know, is a real material fact of its existence, right? So I think often the way that question is posed about free speech and debate and so on is always as if there's this kind of ideal place where it happens, you know, and that anything is permitted and there aren't really any material effects. And I think, like, debate, for example, is the model for politics in Britain, right? It's what people who go to private school are taught. You know, they can take either position, any position, it doesn't really matter. It's not really about the content, it's about whether you can argue. You know, the same goes for law. You can defend or you can prosecute, doesn't really matter. Same goes for parliamentary politics. It's all just, I don't know, posh people banter. And in a sense, it's not really about the content and the material ramifications and impact of the things that are said to some extent. Although, of course, there are real policies that have real material effects, right? But that's not the rhetorical space. And so I'm very wary of defending that model because it is very specific historical and geographical model of debate and this image of free speech. It's very much tied to very like liberal notions of the sovereign individual who can choose what to say because they're not really determined by the content. So I would say that there isn't ever this neutral vacuum space in which something like free speech can take place. It's a very difficult question about, you know, where you know, what is said. I mean, in a way, I'm probably more liberal in a sense on this question. I don't think books should be banned. I don't think anything should be, you know, off limits in terms of how it's discussed or where it's discussed. Although, like I say, it's never in this free space. So, I don't know. I support people opposing the gallery. I think it was a destructive thing they were doing. So, but that's a specific political decision, right, in a material context.
Marvin, do you have anything you want to?
That was a specific question, wasn't it, to Nina?
Oh, was that specific? I mean,
there was a specific question for whoever wants to answer that question.
Well, I'd like to just add something because I think the issue here is not a question of offending people or attacking, you know, feelings that people might have. I mean, racism itself shuts down free speech and open discussion because it excludes, you know. So I think there's a particular structure and issue here that, you know, where it's not a question of allowing any opinion to be expressed because there are some opinions and views that would undermine the very basis for free speech and open discussion. At least that's my view with that. I don't know if anybody has any other thoughts they want to.
Sorry, Michael, can I ask you something else whilst I have a mic? Have you spoken to any artists who are going through immigration to the UK or went through immigration here on their social roles during all those events happening recently and how did they express
Sorry,
their
I didn't
protests?
Catch that question. What the
yeah, have you spoken to any artists who kind of went through immigration to the UK or are going through it currently, and how do they respond to recent activities of that gallery?
I haven't specifically, but
I'm married to a Polish person.
Yeah, what does that person say?
I don't know about the specific his response to your like talking about the gallery. I live in Glasgow, but he's very upset with the current state of feeling that he's not wanted in this country, and he's just waiting to hear what happens, and he feels like he doesn't want to live in this in the UK, to be honest. I think a lot of my friends who are European, I have a lot of friends, I don't know why, when we moved to Glasgow 3 years ago, nearly all my friends are either Swedish, Dutch, Austrian, and Polish, and I think they feel rejected, might be the word. Yeah, and Japanese, actually, but I mean, I don't know, of all my friends, it feels as if it's very personal. They seem to be taking everything very personally. But that doesn't necessarily answer your question. I've looked into fostering a child as well.
I think it's not unconnected with this dreadful phrase, the will of the people, that is bandied about these days. And I mean, there's no such thing. There's no people and there's no will of the people as if the people is a specific agent. But it's this idea, again, of the body, of the people as a body, and you're sort of inside or you're outside, you're one of them or you're not one of them. So I think that immigration question is not unconnected with these kinds of issues and the terrible language of the will of the people that's bandied around with respect to Brexit.
Uh,
Can you get a microphone?
Hello. Okay.
No, someone's asking a question with a microphone.
Oh.
You don't, yeah. Go ahead. Someone at the back doesn't understand.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I just want to take the points that we're talking about in what's happening in outside of Europe that's very contemporary and a very big political problem in a third world setting. So specifically in the Philippines, and there's a big political problem. And this notion of, you talked about the language, but how it's not actually just the words per se, but the actual manner and of speaking that is usually shared by the majority and people can relate to, and this helps in like sort of the rise of the fascist and the idea of temporality. You talked about the idea of temporality, but this fascism's rise is also a result of this long-term and strongly rooted discontent, not just like a temporal, for the sake of being, in the name of being angry, disturb the current state of things, and how it is like, it's this very anger in the state of things, and this like not having a future is used towards having a better future, and this is like a solution, sort of seen as a solution to having an actual future. It's something that's sort of bright and jolly, possibly, and how it's being instrumentalized to cater to this this anger or this imaginary problems that should be solved, and it's to appeal to a clump of people, specifically those that will not be affected by its implications, especially with violence, because it usually affects the poor. The poor body is the one that's always being affected by it, and because it's the most expendable one. And this idea of political momentum through technology, which I've been thinking a lot, is that, like, for instance, in this specific context, like usually in the third world, it's actually back to more archaic things and tactics, like how people are actually being killed on the streets. Like there's like a massive surveillance of knocking into people's houses, getting in the houses and killing them. So I don't know, I just want to have to point out these sort of things that are sort of completely different in different contexts and the other parts of the world.
Thank you. Do either of you want to say anything?
I don't know, it's not relevant necessarily, but I was really amazed by that. I'm sure everyone was, about the film The Act of Killing really shocked me. And that's a really bizarre film where it's a combination of, I don't know, role play and psychology, and I don't know, it's just so intense. But to be honest, I don't mean to sound so ignorant, but I haven't actually watched the whole film because I found it really hard to get hold of. I just watched the interviews around it and as much as I could. But it's not necessarily relevant to your point, but I feel like there's, again, maybe it sounds too positive, but I do feel as if there is some strange human response to situations that you think are unfathomable, like nightmarishly, that we're never going to gain ground again. And yet that team of documentary makers seems to have taken on an incredible amount of responsibility for like investigating the war crimes of an entire country. And they seem willing to handle questions and to really be willing to stand up to that. I don't know if I'm necessarily there, to be honest. I'm 43. As I grow older, I might actually gain more and more courage and more life experience and take on more and more important issues. But I'm really willing to hand the question over, but that's the response. That's all I can give you. Do you understand? That's the best I can give. But I'm really happy for Nina to take the question.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose, of course, it's imperative that we understand like the global hierarchies of violence, right? That you know, what's called violence in one situation is not comparable to violence in another. And, you know, and I mean, I think someone like Theresa May, you know, her obsession with getting the numbers down. I mean, this is just her project, you know. So whether it be people from the EU, whether it be asylum seekers, whether it be international students, you know, the entire plan is just to get the numbers down, and this is her kind of obsessive drive. You know, and I think part of what that does is encourage this somehow, this feeling I was trying to describe of this sort of people who really have, you know, all the space and all the time and everything they could possibly need, nevertheless being pressured or feeling themselves to be victims, you know, to feel that they don't have space and don't have time, you know, and this is this very, you know, worrying and dangerous political affect, I suppose, you know, which means that, like, precisely this question, proximity, people might have a sympathetic moment or a sentimental moment when they understand that violence is happening elsewhere in the world, but not a practical or really deep-seated understanding. You know, that's that sort of global understanding of the differentiated violence or asymmetrical violence is being blocked, yeah, by a kind of encouragement through language, through this kind of differentiation of the other with the other, yeah, which is profoundly anti-humanist and profoundly inhuman. Yeah.
Can I say something?
Yes, please do.
One of the reasons I came to like Harold Pinter is because I was at home and the TV, I turned the TV on, and there was a program where he exposed the media's censorship and placement of video, of footage of the coverage of the Serbian war. And it was on TV, it was on, I think it was on Channel 4. And I remember being so shocked by it, I couldn't stop watching the TV. I just couldn't believe that it was being broadcast, that a criticism of the media was allowed to be broadcast for a start. And then the detail of it and his precise ability to manage it. And there's a brilliant book that you come across at art college called War and Cinema by Paul Virilio. And it's been a long time that people have been analyzing the ability for surveillance and media to control our lives. And I was really excited and amazed with the Harold Pinter program. And I remember ringing my friend, Georgian. He's called Oswald now, but he was called Nedeltovich. And I rang him and I said, my God, are you watching this? Are you watching this? It's incredible. And I don't know who was watching it. Like, seriously, who was watching it? Not many people. It was at midnight. But after that, I started following Harold Pinter, and I got really excited because I feel like there's a level where if you can come across people who are clear and... probably Nina Powell's probably one of them, I'd say, but to able to analyse and scrutinise the contemporary culture that we're in, you slightly have to hang on every word they have to offer. It's like, it's crucial. I don't know who else we're meant to be listening to. You can recognise them when you hear them. Like, that's why I was talking about Frank Zappa, which of course will make people smile. But if you listen to his interviews, he's hard-hitting, he's intense. He took on censorship intensely. He went to court and defended in a brilliant way that I think is exciting and makes you realise that there's totally worth questioning things and being more active. And living in Glasgow, I'm really excited. There's lots of very interesting activist groups where I live, and you feel quite hot and alive rather than dead and depressed and demoralised. And I definitely don't know the answers to the questions, but at the same time, I actually feel like I do believe that people are actually really positive and actually really will make changes. I don't think people are apathetic, au fond. I think that's what we're talking about a little bit, mm-hmm. but I might be wrong. And I think I probably am here representing someone who's more literally idiot-like, willing to take some steps. Like, I will happily take some steps. I don't know.
The last question, I'm told.
Cool. Sorry for yelling earlier. So I'm really interested in the idea when I think, Nina, you brought up exclusive sovereignty and also the idea of blocking and time out of joint. So I find this idea, maybe you guys can talk a little more about it, but how people in power to define sovereignty, whether it's state or state narrative, use the idea of future as a kind of like a rallying cry going forward. But when we have either it be companies or technologies or infrastructures that prevent or block those sort of emotions, whether it be protests, whatever, how do we define the state within a state of untime or time out of joint, and how we defined us in that untime, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was Michael who raised the question of sovereignty in the first place, but I mean, I actually have a really unpopular position on this, which is that I kind of disagree, or at least I think that sovereignty and that the role of the state hasn't disappeared. I think sometimes people think that, you know, because of, like, multinationals and global capitalism, that the state border is you know, less important, and that because of surveillance and the internet and data mining, that you know, that actually the state is less relevant, you know, a kind of, like, I don't know, ambient Foucauldianism or something. I had a big fight with Isabel Laurie recently about this, and she accused me of having some, like, Hobbesian position about the state. But, I mean, I think, you know, it, practically speaking, in the final analysis, you know, the state is pretty damn present. And you know, the more that the welfare state is eroded, that the state becomes purely repressive, you know, that the state is just prisons, courts, you know, refugee centres, you know, and even if some of these things are outsourced or privatised or franchised, in the final analysis, the state will back up anybody who kills somebody they're deporting, for example, whether, you know, if you're working for Serco or G4S or anyone who's killed in a private prison, right? So I don't really accept this argument that somehow everything has been kind of deracinated and the state is irrelevant. I think sovereignty is real. I think these definitions of who gets to decide what is public, right, is still a very, very top-down issue, and you know, it's about the how do we decide the balance between capital and the state. You know, I mean, it was the state that bailed out the banks. You know, it wasn't pure free market capital, otherwise all the banks would have gone to the wall, right? It's not what happened, right? The state steps in and stops these things, right? And I think trying to work out what the relation between state and capital is maybe, like, one of the hardest questions, and I think you can get easily misled following one route or the other, but we have to think both and think it globally, right? So I tried to describe this loose interconnection of authoritarian nationalisms, which itself comprises a form of internationalism, authoritarian internationalism, against which we no longer, in a sense, have a kind of communist internationalism, or at least an image of internationalism that had a kind of communist dimension. So I'm very interested in what it might mean to frame a positive internationalism that would unite people against authoritarian nationalism, right, and their version of the international. But that's a really difficult question here, yeah? Whether it be a humanism, or whether we can no longer use a kind of humanism because of the problems with humanism. That's I'll leave it open as a question because I don't know.
Do you feel that idea of positive internationalism resonates with you, Marvin, in terms of your,
like,
own practice?
It's like, I was going to say the Josephine Baker's Rainbow People. It's like it's more naive. It's like it's a literal naive directness that I have. And if it was going to be that somehow I could, you know, have some sort of impact, I can imagine it's quite intimate and local rather than on a global level. And I'm pretty naive. I'd say I'm really naive and pretty romantic. I try really hard not to be. So I don't really know if I could say that I believe in some sort of mad overall happy ending or something like this, other than communism.
But how does that localism interact with the sort of you as an international artist as well? I mean, how does an artist negotiate the relation between the local and the international?
Film seems to be quite useful, to be honest. Because, I mean, sorry, if I'm making work that's intimate and grassroots and within my reach, like I'm literally doing it, making it happen, that it seems that if I manage to make bawdy, outrageously alive video, that seems to be robust enough to carry to a bigger audience. But that's just a basic answer. But I think maybe you're talking more ideologically or something, are you?
No, okay. In practical terms.
Okay,
really.
In practical terms I can handle.
On that note, I think we'll have to call it an evening.
Okay.
Thanks very much to Nina and Marvin, yeah, and to you.